Good morning, Wairarapa. This is Anna Cardino from Wairarapa DHB with Wraparound Wairarapa. This is an opportunity to connect services within our community to make sure that the people out there know what is available for them in terms of health and well-being and all sorts of other things here in the Wairarapa, with you every Wednesday morning on Arrow FM at 9 a.m. And today I am extremely delighted to have Kelly Huxford, who is our opioid substitution team leader at Pathways. Kelly, welcome to the show. Oh, it's lovely to have you here. And today we are learning all about something I've got to admit, I have no idea. I really don't understand. No, I am completely ignorant when it comes to I've done something wrong, because here's Michael. Now, there we are. We haven't got you on the... I do this every time. I haven't got the right microphone on. Now we have Kelly Huxford with us this morning, who is the opioid substitution team leader at Pathways. Michael, go away. You're distracting me. Kelly, we'll do that again. Welcome. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me, Anna. I love being here.
Good, good. And it's really neat to have the opportunity to talk about opioids, because it's something that I have, bye-bye Michael, have nothing, no idea about. So you told me a really interesting fact when we were off air just now, about opioid addiction and what that, you know, how it starts for many people is actually through the prescribing.
Absolutely.
Of drugs through the medical, through the system. So somebody needs medicines, they get prescribed something, and then they end up with an addiction to opioid. So how about we start with talking about what an opioid is, and then how people get in this state?
Yeah, look, absolutely. And it's quite a large portion of the people that we look after at Pathways come to us having been prescribed opioids from their doctor. And there's a little bit more to it than just that, but generally speaking, that's how it begins for a lot of people. And to cover off, first of all, what an opioid actually is. So opioids are a class of analgesic. They are pain relievers. And they're quite widely prescribed for people for good reason. They're very, very effective. They're one of the tools that doctors use to treat quite high-end pain.
Mm-hmm.
And they do the job well.
So what? So for people like myself, little, you know, mm-hmm. ignorant on the subject, what are the trade names or the yep. normal useful names that people understand? You know, what do we call, what are some opioids in sort of everyday language?
Morphine-based products, yep. And there's a range of those. There's long-acting morphine and there's short-acting morphine, and they have different sorts of trade names. Codeine is another one, and of course codeine's just recently been through a change for this very reason. You used to be able to get codeine over the counter at the chemist, and now you have to get it via prescription as a safety measure. There's some other ones as well. There's a drug called tramadol or Tramil, which is a bit of a synthetic type opioid, but it has an opioid-like effect. And there's a few others that are often used in hospital and as, you know, when someone's monitored a little more closely, but they tend to be the main ones.
And sure, and each of those, I think we all know, don't we? Because, I mean, I myself have been on every one that you just simply mentioned for
yeah.
different, you know, different issues that I've had, ended up in hospital and my children. So how easy is it then for someone to become addicted or be reliant?
Well, there's all sorts of different research around how people end up having dependency, and I think before we go into that, I might just talk about a little bit what dependency might actually means, because I don't want to alarm people who are already taking these medicines quite safely. So dependency comes about when there's been a physiological change in the brain. So it means that the person who's been taking these medicines, usually for a longer period than intended, and usually at doses that are above the recommended range, start having a change in the brain where essentially the receptors in the brain that receive the drug and make it activate and work become kind of overloaded, and they develop dependency to it, which means that the drug doesn't work particularly well anymore and they need to take a bit more for it to be effective, or they try to stop taking the medicine and they start having withdrawal type symptoms. So they start feeling very agitated and a bit of anxiety, and they might get some hot and cold sweats, and they might get some cramps or some gastrointestinal problems, and they start to think, why am I feeling so sick? And the only time that these symptoms go away is when I take one of my painkillers again. They don't realise often that it's actually a dependency type problem that's developed.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that actually complicates things for people in itself, doesn't it? If your dependency is borne about by, because that's providing you the relief, and I suppose that's sort of how addiction starts, is it provides a relief for somebody to get themselves out of a situation that's unpleasant. Yeah.
Absolutely.
So that's easy to get into.
Yeah, and it's something that's growing, and it's growing because we've got an aging population, and we've got people who have chronic long-term pain. And one of the things we know about opioids is that they're very, very effective at relieving pain. But when someone has chronic long-term pain, they're taking these drugs for much longer than what was initially intended. They're developing tolerance because they're taking them for so long. They need higher and higher doses to achieve the effect, the pain relief effect. And it's just suddenly building to a point where you're getting that physiological change. And when it comes time to make a shift or a change, suddenly you've got a dependency issue. And, you know, as we're aging and getting older, people are developing longer-term chronic pain. There's another little side to it too, is that opioids are also, we now know, that they can actually make the pain worse in chronic patients at times. It's called hyperalgesia, and it's where opioids actually change the nerve structure and make pain develop their own pain pathways, I think is the best way to put it. And opioids can actually create that long term. So there's some real kind of key messages that come out of this, because I think the one thing I want to get across to people is that opioid dependency is completely avoidable when you are prescribed opioids. And there's some key things to really talk about with your doctor upfront when you first prescribe these medicines, so that you're not one of those people that comes a crop of but further down the track.
Sure, and it sounds like anybody could be that person that comes a cropper. It's not somebody who's necessarily, you know, has a predisposition to addictions of some other sort or what have you. It's, you know, anybody can be trapped by that.
Yeah. It is really important to understand too that people can be opioid dependent, and you can get withdrawal symptoms when you cease these medicines, and you can need higher doses over a period of time, and that can still be okay, and your doctor's always the best guide for that. But where we're actually starting to see prescribed opioid dependency becoming really problematic is when people have other factors. So you are right to talk about people with histories of dependency, so that we know that if you've got somebody with a history of dependencies to other things, you know, alcoholism or benzodiazepines or any sort of street drug, that they're a little bit higher risk to consider when you're prescribing opioids, because you know they have a background of dependency. You would need to be a little bit careful about applying a drug of dependence to them. The other thing to think about is people can take opioids perfectly safely for a really long period of time. They're managing their pain. They're not taking more than what they should. Perhaps they're taking regular breaks from those opioids without any undue effect. But then all sorts of things can happen in that person's life. One of the things with opioids is that they, in suppressing pain, they also suppress other things. So people find them beneficial for sleep. They are very sedating.
Right, people, so they find help them people sleep.
Beneficial, right, for stress and anxiety. I've had patients talk to me about opioids feeling like a warm, comfortable blanket. And when we talk about the stresses of life, particularly this year, you know, people isolated in their homes and going through all sorts of financial difficulties and employment struggles and worried about the health of their family, suddenly you might have somebody who takes, you know, morphine or tramadol or codeine for pain, and they think, well, actually it's helping me sleep, so I might take a few extra to help me sleep, or I'm finding I'm not able to face the stresses I've got during the day, I might take a little bit more aside from pain, to just take the edge off how I'm feeling. And that can be the beginnings of that increase in tolerance. The psychological dependency starts to develop. They need it to get through whatever it is they're going through. And then that can very quickly escalate what's just a physical dependency, which is those physical changes in the brain and a little bit of withdrawal, to suddenly we've got somebody who's developed a real strong sense that they cannot cope in life without these medicines.
So like a total emotional dependency on day-to-day, can't get through without it.
Absolutely.
The stock standard idea that we have of what addiction means. Yeah.
And they tend to be the sorts of patients that we see in our server. So what might have started out as just a routine prescription that they got from their doctor because they broke their ankle or fell over and hurt their hip or something, you know, perfectly appropriately applied opioids. And, you know, it's been beneficial for a long, long time until suddenly it's gotten on top of them. And they've needed to ask their doctor for more and more, either in dosage or in supply. And they've started to recognise that they're actually not able to get through the day or the night
without
taking these medicines. And not just for pain, but for other reasons as well.
I suppose also that would make it quite difficult for your GP monitoring how that's going for you, because it would become, I imagine, quite commonplace for people to perhaps escalate the way they are articulating their pain so that they, you know, say that my pain's worse because he will give me more drugs, or, you know, she's going to keep my prescription going if I say that I'm still sore, and so therefore I will. Yeah, so it must be quite difficult from the GP point of view as well.
You've absolutely nailed one of the key issues, because a lot of people sort of turn their attention to doctors and say, well, you know, they've created this, they've prescribed it, they've given it to me long term, they keep putting up my dose. But when somebody is, you know, physically and psychologically dependent on a substance, it's perfectly rational for them to go to their doctor and to say what they need to say in order to keep their supply going. And in many cases, and this is where things start to get a bit ropey too, the doctors start to pick up that things are starting to get a little bit difficult. They're concerned about the dose or the amount of supply. They believe that the pain perhaps should have resolved by now and it hasn't, and they start putting a few restrictions in place about dosage and supply. And because this dependent person is struggling, there is a market, a street market of opioids available, and people share their prescriptions with each other and sell on their prescriptions to other people. And then you're really starting to get into the illicit use of opioids, which is taking it to another level again. This is how powerful these drugs can be if they're mishandled. Somebody who would never have expected to buy morphine or codeine off the street, you know, and in a few years they're noticing that that's actually what they're looking to do. So you can imagine how that must feel for somebody to have gone from getting a prescribed amount safely from their GP to buying it from their neighbour or a friend or somebody they don't even know.
Absolutely. And so, Kelly, from your perspective, do you think there is enough that's said? Do you think there's enough communication out there and that people are aware of this as clearly a major issue?
Look, I think you've already sort of pointed out that, you know, GPs are under a hell of a lot of pressure out there. We all know how difficult it is to even get a GP appointment in this region, let alone have a full-on conversation about your health.
Yeah, well, I think it's a national thing, isn't it?
It's really hard.
Difficult.
And you've often only got, you know, 5 or 10 minutes sitting in the room with your GP. And, you know, GPs are wanting to help you. They're wanting to treat your pain. And, you know, remember, a lot of people who are dependent to opioids do genuinely have pain. Mm. And so opioids are still considered gold standard for pain relief. And I think some of the GP practices are perhaps a little bit better than others. I know some practices have contracts that they ask clients to sign. So they have that little education session up front that these are medicines that we have to monitor very closely. You're required to come in person for each review. We're going to restrict how many repeats we give you without seeing you. And there's also things that medicines control do at a higher level to monitor GPs' patterns of prescribing. But what I'm trying to put across here is really empowerment of yourself in talking through your healthcare with your GP. And have the conversations about how can I safeguard myself, knowing that these are drugs of dependence. What are some non-opioid based things that I can do to improve my pain and prevent me from needing them longer than intended or at higher doses than recommended, because that's what we're trying to avoid here.
Mm.
We're trying to say to patients that although opioids are often needed, try and keep the use of them as short as possible. Try and keep the dosages as low as possible, still effective. We're not wanting people to be going through horrendous levels of pain, but the lowest possible effective dose. And wherever there's an opportunity where your pain is perhaps a little bit lower on the spectrum to what you were experiencing before, take regular breaks from taking those opioids. So you're giving your body the chance to keep that tolerance to them really high, so that when you need them, you're not going to need high doses and so that, long period of time.
And so that they're effective.
So that they're effective.
So part of what you were discussing then, part of what you just mentioned, and for anybody that's just tuned into Arrow FM this morning, well, this is Wrap Around Wairarapa Show. We're talking this morning about opioids and opioid substitution with our opioid substitution team leader, Kelly Huxford from Pathways. What you mentioned just before, Kelly, was you were talking about something that echoed to me what we do at the hospital in terms of when a patient is admitted for whatever purpose, we start thinking about discharge planning from the minute they arrive, because people can have that sort of, you know, you can come into hospital and you can get into your pajamas and you can get into bed and you can have that feeling that I am sick, I am ill, I am injured, I am whatever, and you just sort of submit to those that know how to treat you, and there's that sort of ongoing, I'm here until they tell me I can leave. So we've sort of been looking at how we turn that around into more of a discharge planning. So you're in hospital until we can fix and treat you, and then you will be going. So people are already thinking about life beyond hospital. It doesn't become business as usual.
Yeah, yeah.
What you were talking about then is people that are prescribed opioids right from the minute they are prescribed them for their pain relief, thinking about how they're actually going to monitor their health and their pain reaction and all of those things to actually ease themselves off this pretty, you know, hefty drug. So getting that sort of information to people right at the beginning so that they don't consider themselves reliant on it from day one. I guess that's sort of the key, one of the key messages, isn't it? This is a short-term fix. This is not something that we're going to have you on for the rest of your
life. I believe absolutely that doctors who prescribe opioids are obligated from the very beginning to explain to patients that these are drugs that are effective for pain, but they do come with some risk factors, one of which is developing a dependency. These are also dangerous drugs if they are taken in excess. They can suppress your respiration rate, and people can overdose on these medicines if they're not monitored. So these are the sorts of safety things that doctors are absolutely obligated to talk about with their patients. And
in your experience, Kelly, doctors are doing that? There's a general understanding, and doctors are very intelligent people, and obviously not just doctors, but any prescribing clinician, so nurse practitioners presumably. So they're all aware of this, and in practice is that...
I would say it's a little mixed.
Right.
I would say that there are some doctors who are, particularly careful and in many ways very, very conservative around the prescribing of drugs of dependence, perhaps sometimes to the point where they're withholding effective medicines for people. And then there's the other end of the spectrum where there's doctors who do seem to prescribe them in quite large supplies and for long periods of time without conducting those reviews. But... that's the role of medicines control. These are medicines that are considered controlled substances. Well, some of them are. And they do monitor doctors' prescribing practice. And I know that there are probably doctors that get a phone call from time to time and encouraged to reduce down the levels of prescribing to safeguard the community. But, you know, on the whole, I think it's something that's absolutely improving, because a lot of the research that's coming through that filters through to GPs is all of the other ways that pain can be effectively managed. And we forget about that. We've become a society where we're experiencing pain and we believe that we are fundamentally rightful about getting a pill to take that away.
I think that's part of this. We live in such an immediate society. Yeah. I mean, this became really, really obvious through the COVID response, didn't it? That we are so immediate in everything that we do. We want to, you know, we're thinking about cooking dinner tonight, so we'll go to the supermarket and we'll get it, and it's all on the day, it's in the moment, it's everything we do right now. And we also, I think, as a generally speaking, as a nation, as a society, probably globally, we have this expectation that science and advancements and improvements are being made every day, and it's our right to then be, you know, to avail ourselves of that. So if there is a medicine for something, we will take it. It's the short term for everything. It's the immediate, something's wrong, I'll take a pill, it will fix it. Not, oh, look at how much exercise I'm doing, how much, how, what sort of food I'm eating, how I live my life. If I have trouble sleeping, I'll put X, Y, and Z in place, and in a month's time I might see an improvement.
Yeah.
We are very quick to say, let's take a pill, and in half an hour I'm going to be asleep. Boom.
And there that's what lies we want. Part of the problem. And we have, you know, a lot of people who have these chronic pain conditions that actually worsen over time, and they believe that because they've been pain-free previously, you know, when their tolerance to the opioids was still really strong and the condition perhaps wasn't quite as bad as it is today, things have degenerated a little bit and shifted and changed, they just want to maintain their pain-free status rather than, well, let's see if we can just take the edge off the pain so that you can still have quality of life but not necessarily be pain-free. And this is where doctors are put under a great deal of pressure by people who are actually just wanting what they want. And I was pain-free last year, why can't I be today? And why can't my dose go up? And why can't you give me an extra lunchtime tablet? And, you know, and GPs want to see their patients well. And we know that dependency, not everybody is going to develop a really problematic dependency to opioids. There's people who take them and don't develop dependencies to them because they manage them appropriately. And so GPs prescribe them, believing that they are effective and it's appropriate. And so this is where the relationship with your GP is so important. It's about the patient, you know, being empowered with knowledge for themselves and safeguarding themselves and doing all those wraparound things, looking at diet, looking at exercise. We know that when it comes to pain management, mindfulness techniques are just as powerful as pharmaceuticals. People who really learn to do those pain messaging, relaxation controls, can be just as effective for long-term pain management as medicines and pills.
Do you think, though, that we know that? Do you think, I mean, and something you just said, Kelly, was really, I think, quite pivotal, and it really is a fundamental part of how we need to probably reshape our community messaging around empowering people to manage their own health. I don't know necessarily that people are aware of those tools that they can apply to themselves easily at no cost to actually help themselves and their pain status and how they live their lives. You know, that self-managing, keep yourself well, do all you can, don't rely on your doctor to fix you all of the time. I don't know that we message that as well as we should.
Yeah, I would agree with you, you know, and it's, again, it's a resourcing issue. And, you know, and some of the really good things aren't free. You know, some of the really good pain management courses, and, you know, I think about things like chiropractors and physios and getting all of those, you know, fitness plans in place and getting really sound anti-inflammatory nutritional advice. These things are not free for the mainstream. These are things that you have to seek privately, and they're really expensive. And, of course, again, we go back to you sitting in a room with a GP for 10 or 15 minutes and they haven't got the time to go into the detail of all the extra things that that person can be doing. And so, you know, the prescription just gets renewed.
There are some things that people can apply within their own lives. You know, I'm thinking of the five ways to well-being and things like mindfulness and being aware, you know, your five senses, you know, just in the immediate right now, what can you see, what can you feel, what can you touch, what can you smell?
Yep.
Just bringing yourself back and centered into the present and taking your mind away from whatever it is that's frustrating you. You know, those sort of simple measures. And again, the COVID response brought some some of that to the fore about how we can keep each other, look out for each other and ensure that we are emotionally safe. And, you know, some of those things I think we can apply on a far more regular basis. You're absolutely right when it comes to physio, chiro, those sorts of things.
Yeah.
But some of the sort of more general understanding of what exercise you can do that will give you all-round wellness and perhaps help with pain relief and help with sleep, just things like going for a walk, you know, all of those things can make such a difference.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And they're things that we, you know, advocate quite strongly in our service because, of course, we see people, you know, part of my role in the opioid team, we see people from all walks of life. I think people would be quite surprised to hear that coming from a specialist addiction service. There's all sorts of images that are conjured up as to the types of people that we might treat. And actually, we see people from all walks of life who have developed dependencies for a whole range of completely different reasons. And so, you know, we have all of these ideas, and it's part of our treatment planning with people, is what, how do we take what's developed? How do we take this person who is taking usually much higher doses than was initially intended over much longer periods of time than we wished to? How do we actually continue to look after them? We don't want to take these medicines away. Taking the medicines away is going to cause a whole health issue of its own, and not be beneficial. So we actually have to look at a wraparound package of the right types of medication, avoiding withdrawal, managing withdrawal if it comes through, improving the person's tolerance so that their pain can be better managed in the future, and giving them these extra tools, all of the stuff we talked about, the lifestyle changes that are going to really impact positively on people's well-being, and empowering them around their capabilities, because we see people who have just lost all sense that they're even capable of change. They've often made multiple attempts to change their situation and failed. And so empowering the person that they're capable of this change, and we do it very gently over a very, very long period of time with lots of support. That's how we get positive outcomes.
So interesting, isn't it? It's just a whole web for people of getting themselves sort of swamped by so many different things they're in that situation. Because, I mean, let's face it, pain is a dreadful thing. You know, to be in pain is awful. You know, right from birth, a child will cry if it is feeling any sort of pain. And we don't escape that, do we, anytime? No. I don't think any person at any point says, okay, well, I'm going to be in pain for the rest of my life and that's okay by me. You know, we do get to a point where we want to have that pain managed. So I can certainly see how easy it would be to get into this dependency situation that you're talking about. And you're right when you say that we have this sort of image in our heads of what an addict or what a dependent person, substance abuse, what they might look like, you know. And you're immediately thinking, you know, ghettos or the opposite. You're thinking the superstars that have got so much money, so much wealth and so much access to everything. You know, that's what you're thinking. But actually it could be your legal professional, your health professional themselves. It could be anybody, couldn't it, in that situation?
It happens. Yeah. It happens to all of us. And I think the key takeaway messages are, this is a completely avoidable situation for people, and I'm just going to encourage anybody who takes long-term pain relief or is even prescribed pain relief short-term, talk to your doctor. The doctors do have this knowledge. And just ask, is this a drug that I can develop a dependency to, and how can I avoid that? How can I make sure that it's effective for me, but that I'm keeping myself safe from developing problems with this medicine?
So that's a great tip for people who are being prescribed sort of for the first time. What would be your advice to somebody listening to the show this morning who feels that they might be caught in this trap already?
Talk to your doctor, talk to the person who's prescribing it to you in the first instance. If you're getting to the level where you know that you've made those attempts and it isn't working, you're welcome to come to Pathways.
And so, excellent, Kelly. So how do they find you? How do they find Pathways?
You can be referred via your GP. You can self-refer if you choose. You can come up. We have a duty person available each day. You can come into the service. We're on level one in the departmental building on Chapel Street.
That's the big, tall, multi-level building.
The big skyscraper, yep. The master
There's only
skyscraper.
One of them. That's where Pathways is, so everybody can find you there.
You can find us there, mm-hmm. And we'll just briefly take your information and someone will be in touch with you. If you're concerned about a family member, you can come in and talk to us about that as well. We do look after family as part of this.
Brilliant.
So any referral stream's fine.
Any way to refer into the departmental building to see Kelly at Pathways and her team, and they will be there to help you. So thank you. This is drawing to a close. This is the end of our time. We could talk all day.
We could.
But Kelly, thank you so much for coming in. It's been really enlightening, and I hope listeners out there have really learnt something. I sure have today.
Thank you.
Thank
I've
you.
I've loved it. Thanks.
Good.
Thank you.